Arcanax login confirmed.
Welcome to the Lodge. You've accessed
the Lodgecast experience.
Warning, warning. Dangerous spoilers ahead. Enjoy.
The Lodgecast is a little podcast where we watch weird movies so you don't have to.
The Lodgecast, baby.
Lodgecast, gonna smoke this. Lodgecast, listen, movie pass. Lodgecast,
we're gonna watch some crap.
Lodgecast,
and then the Lodgemaster chats
with Lucas and Bishki.
Episode 143, Lifemark.
Hello and welcome to a sanctimonious episode of the Lodgecast. I'm your Lodgemaster with me as always is Brother Bishki.
For such a time as this.
Oh, for such a time as this. And because this is yet another Christian Fathom event, Brother Lucas is out of the edge for this one.
Heathen.
To preserve his sanity.
We're going to get him at some Christian event sometime, but yeah.
But as you've already just heard, we got the world's best glutton for punishment. Brother Antony is back.
Blessed be.
And tonight, we have a very special guest, very special indeed, with something to say about Kirk Cameron and the Cam Fam. We got Brother Josh.
Praise the Lord. I'm like a virgin to this, but not the virgin, because that's sacrilegious.
Oh my God. Welcome, guys. Sister Emily would have loved to have completed this voyage of the doomed, but she made a solemn vow to me that she will be back for God's Not Dead. Part 5.
Yes. Oh. Coming in 2023.
Count me in for that as well.
And yeah. It promises to be political this time.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm
not like We the People wasn't political enough.
Not like the last four, no.
So tonight the movie is Lifemark.
Is that what it's called?
Lifemark.
Lifemark.
Wow. I have no idea what that even means.
I don't know either. I don't know if we're going to find out.
I've been getting the marketing campaign, but I won't spoil. Like, you don't know anything, Anthony?
Do you know what Lifemark is?
I don't know what Lifemark is. I know what I'm kind of getting the gist of what the
I know
movie
what
is
the
about.
Movie is.
I mean, look, yeah. Boys, you had me at Kirk Cameron. I said, I'm there. I don't even know what this movie's about, quite honestly. Okay. So
well, maybe we'll be vague on those details because I know what it's about.
I know a little bit, but like with any Cam Fam Jam, you can never know everything.
Josh, do you know what Lifemark is about? Vaguely?
I spoiled myself a little bit by looking at the Internet Movie Database page just to see what I was in for today.
I think we can just generally state that it's going to be a pro-life film.
I am pro for it then.
Oh, this, got it.
I am pro life, Mark.
Pro and pro adoption.
Yeah. Pro adoption. So it's a little rough that it's four dudes in the car tonight, but we.
Who better than us?
We are going to carry the flag, keep the torch alight, and do the best we can handling this material. So instead of talking and speculating about what Lifemark possibly means, let's talk to Brother Josh a little bit, because last time we went into the Cam Fam Jam was the
Homeschool Awakening.
Homeschool Awakening.
The controversial Homeschool
controversial
Awakening episode.
That split us up. There was mutiny on the Bounty, and I couldn't even handle it. Emily and I went off to the Golden Girls special event.
Brother Judas over here.
So when I mentioned to Josh that we were doing such a thing, he was like, oh my, do you know my origin story? And I was like, oh my, maybe I don't. So Josh, what is your origin story, sir?
Oh my gosh, this is such a dramatic like lead up.
Oh, we're so ready. And this is a safe space to do whatever you need to do.
Well, so partially I felt a little FOMO missing out on this because I was homeschooled my entire life.
Okay.
Which made put some pieces into place.
Oh, we should have. You should have been there, man.
Yeah. So, yeah, I was homeschooled the whole time, basically all the way from first grade to graduating high school.
Wow.
Luckily, high school was a little bit off the path where, you know, there's a little bit more interaction with other people.
Right.
Is a little bit more like independent study, college prep. And, you know, we had a site, we had teachers, blah, blah, blah.
Anyway. But until then, you weren't interacting with other kids on a daily basis?
No, I mean, no, just my sister. That was it.
One sister. Yeah.
I mean, you know, we had like field trips and stuff, but that was like once a month.
Right.
So,
and what were those field trips, religious?
I mean, not necessarily. See, that's the thing, is that there's a lot of religious conservatives in this homeschool program.
Sure.
Not just conservative Christians, but also a lot of conservative Muslims were in there as well.
Right.
Because, you know, it's all about like protecting their kids from indoctrination of, you know, atheistic values, the
evils,
or whatever.
The yeah. evils.
The secular.
Yeah. So, I mean, you know, it wasn't weird for me, and I don't really feel like I missed out a whole lot, I guess, other than meeting people my own age on a regular basis.
So you're pro homeschool all the way. No exceptions.
Oh, no. I'm 100% anti homeschooling, actually, which don't tell my mom.
Sure.
You can edit this out on the.
I mean, she's a super fan.
Yeah.
She's a super fan.
No, Judy listens to every episode for sure. So mom, if you're listening to this, I'm lying.
Yeah. So what made you come to that conclusion? Was it seeing and sampling the fruits of the outside, or what turned you?
Well, I mean, I was pretty lucky because our program was pretty well regulated by the state.
Whoa, really?
But wow. Yeah, where, you know, I was like turning in actual like samples of homework to the state, making sure that like I was actually being educated properly.
Because it seemed with this Kirk Cameron homeschool shit, it was just
no regulation.
Just random.
Oh, yeah. You would just go on vacation with your family, do some parkour. Right.
Yeah. A lot of parkour. Did you ever do parkour?
No. Aww. No. Yeah, no. So, but that's the problem with things is like, you know, if you're outside, you know, I mean, a lot of these homeschooling programs aren't being supervised. So it's like, you right. can just like use your Bible as a textbook if you wanted to. And then, you know, these kids aren't getting a real education. And I think it's awful.
Right. And you can just make up shit, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's like, I mean, my parents are pretty smart people. So, you know, they both have like, you know, pretty good degrees and stuff. So, I mean, I was lucky in that regard too, but it's like, you know, if you just have some like, I don't know, it's not good.
So was like Kirk Cameron, John Wayne in your family?
No, actually, Kirk Cameron didn't come up really until later in youth group.
Oh, shit.
You know, yes. Not only homeschool, but also conservative Christian back in the day.
Ooh.
Yeah, so back in the day, Kirk Cameron, I think he might still do this. He actually had a pretty close relationship with this dude who headed up like a proselytizing. What's the other word for proselytizing?
Witnessing?
Yeah. It's like, it was like this like ministry or whatever, where right. they're like, here's how you go up to random people and tell
was
them
he
they're
an
going
older,
to hell.
Like a slightly older gentleman?
Yes, with a mustache. A
lot of videos of them.
Yes.
Like, early YouTube was passing their videos around a lot, just being like, look at these guys.
Yes. Living Waters, I think was the name of it.
Oh, wow.
And basically their whole thing is like, here's a great conversation starter. Go up to someone and ask them if they're a good person. If they say
right,
yes,
right.
bring them through the Ten Commandments yep. and show them that they're a total piece of shit.
Yep.
I do that at bars, so it usually works.
I remember that's what it was. It was just this manipulative bullshit. And they had those looks in their eyes that just that glazed over glassy look. It's like, how do you get through to these people, these evil people?
Yeah.
No,
yeah.
In my Christian days, the witnessing was a big, like, so awkward and uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. But anyway, yeah.
So you and the youth group were like, were you guys watching his movies, his Left Behind series? Like, were you, what facet of Cameron were you guys tripping out on?
Yeah, I mean, I definitely saw the Left Behind movie back in the day.
And you were watching it with like tented fingers and you were nodding and it was like making sense to you?
Yes. Oh, and I had devoured those books too as well.
Oh,
I mean, the youth versions, not the adult ones.
Oh, yeah.
Wow. Mm-hmm, there's a YA
watered
series.
Yeah. Down, Left Behind.
Yeah.
No, I want the NC-17 version of Left Behind. Don't give me this YA crap.
And were the movies like the airplane version? Version, like edited for content, or did you guys mainline those?
Yeah, well, I mean, we only saw that very, very first one with Kirk Cameron, which I think was PG.
There's some scary elements, you know?
Yeah, you know, it's a little spooky, but you know, it's all in the service of the Lord,
right?
You know, teaching about the Antichrist in the coming days.
What about the one that I still haven't seen, Fireproof?
Fireproof. Directed by this the duo. Well, not at least produced by the duo that's doing tonight's movie.
Okay, sweet. So it's all connected.
The Kendrick's brothers.
Yeah, yeah, I think I dropped off a little bit before his big explosion into like movies and everything.
Right.
I was mostly watching like the videos from his little like you know.
You were there when he was cool, like before he was,
yeah,
before he blew up. Like you were one of the cool, you know, like before Metallica blew up.
Yeah,
Scene kids.
Exactly. Exactly. Like, I was like listening to like Belle and Sebastian in the early 90s kind of thing. So yeah, before he was cool.
Yeah. Underground Cameron stuff.
Yeah. But yeah, we like that, like that was kind of like traumatizing. Not seriously traumatizing. I use that word lightly. But like, I'm a 15 year old kid and they're like, hey, let's go out to this like, you know, little downtown area, and I want you to go up to random people and tell them that they're going to hell. I'm like, I don't want to do this.
Yeah.
By the way, spoiler alert, I never did.
Thank God.
But I'm just like, I don't want to do this. This is awkward.
We could definitely do it tonight. Although it looks like there's not going to be that many people.
That was my next question. Yeah, this is a Fathom event, right?
This is a week long Fathom event.
Week long.
Somehow, Kirk.
Is that even legal?
After the success of Homeschool Awakening.
That a success?
No, it wasn't. No. But he was like, we need Lifemark in theaters for a week. Yeah. And so I've been looking at the theater every day and it's just empty.
It's just empty. I saw four seats in there.
They all belong to us.
But they're not us.
Oh.
Whoa.
More on that in a moment. But Josh, how did you get out? Like, how did you get away from this?
Did you?
Are you undercover and you're going to witness to us tonight?
Lodgemaster, do you believe you're a good person?
Oh, shit. Oh, fuck.
No, I mean, honestly, it was just kind of like, it wasn't like a sudden moment.
It just faded?
Yeah, it just kind of faded away. And then I was like...
It's like believing in Santa Claus.
Yeah.
You just kind of stop after a while.
Yeah.
Speak for yourself.
And you go to college, you get exposed to new ideas. I don't know. This was my case.
The Bischke origin story.
Yeah. This is in my case, like freshman year, you know, where you just like, you're getting all these conflicting ideas and you're just like, this is kind of driving me nuts. So I need to like open my mind a little bit.
Right.
And expand my horizons and not be fundamentalist Christian for my...
And then if you're curious, if you're of a curious mind, which both of you guys are, you just kind of even out.
Yeah. So it's kind of a fade out. It's not like not like a screw you, mom and dad. Like, you know, like,
I didn't get like a piercing at like 16 or something. But yeah, I mean, that's the thing is like when you're in this like fundamentalist Christianity is so much of it is wrapped around with like surrounding yourself with other Christians.
Yes.
So it's like it's just such a feedback loop.
It seems normal.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So you're like. Yeah, praise the Lord.
Trump.
Yeah.
Well, luckily we got out before that shit.
Oh, my God.
Thank you for sharing your story.
Yeah. Thank you, Josh. Yeah.
Tonight, we are being a little mischievous because this Fathom event is not covered by AMC A-List.
Tickets were like, what, $17?
$18 pop for Lifemark.
So I had my credit card out.
And I was like, Bischke, I don't know if we should do this. And you're like, no, we're going to do it.
And then I had my credit card out. I was about to put it in. I was like, wait a minute. I calculated everything. I was like, this is going to cost us 36, 72. Oh, my God. What am I doing? Yes. So we just said we're going to sit in the back row.
Yep.
We got to figure out what theater it is.
I know. I bought a ticket just to see what theater it was and then refunded it.
Oh, good.
Set an alarm on my iPhone for... 5 minutes from now to remind us what theater it's in.
Is this a first for the Lodgecast?
This is a first.
Wow. Yeah.
I'm
honored to be part of the first.
We bought the tickets to Nope.
We're going to Nope again, guys, if anybody asks you.
And it's like third month of release.
Yeah, that's right.
This is like when I would buy, when I was like a kid and I bought tickets for Gremlins 2, but I wanted to see Ford Fairlane.
Oh, shit.
So this is kind of the same thing.
That's a smooth move, Andy.
Yeah, we're doing teenager moves here, yeah.
So I think we sit all the way in the back and all the way to the side, just in case there's another crew.
This is a very covert operation.
It's
I love
covert,
it.
And I always say this, but it's mainly for Emily, and Emily's not here tonight. You got to play it cool in there, okay?
This is true.
Like, you can't be yelling at the screen. You can't be, like, talking back. We're undercover tonight.
You can't be walking out, Lodge Master.
That's, yes, thank you. Thank you.
I didn't want that particular stipulation.
We're making a pact right now.
Listen, I know I need to serve my penance tonight. I brought plenty of weed. I'm going to get some fucking mellow yellow and mellow the fuck out. It's a solid 2 hours.
Ooh,
oh, you didn't say that. We
gotta,
God damn it.
We got to get to MacGuffin's, folks. Man.
We got to get to MacGuffin's.
I need at least two drinks this.
I wish I should have brought some communion wafers to snack on.
Got
to
drink the blood of Christ. If MacGuffin's knew anything, they would have a Cameron-specific drink.
They have a Lifemark margarita.
Lifemark.
Yeah.
All right. Well, let's go face this thing and then figure out what the fuck we just saw.
Oh, God.
Origin stories abound, but now it's time to go to the source. It's a Cam Fam Jam, y'all.
Love and life, Mark.
Love and life. Oh boy, that nope sure was scary. Wow.
Jordan Peele, you done it again.
From the mind of Jordan Peele, we did not go to nope. We went down the hall, past the nope, to a theater where there were some senior citizens gathered around.
Four, and then a one loner.
Yes.
But they were all very pleasant to each other, I noticed. They said, oh, have a good night at the end.
Yeah.
And
but before we got into the theater, just coming out of the elevator, what the hell was it? There was like a bizarro group of dudes that came out of the elevator. One was hacking up a lung, coughing, and the other one was just like farting really loudly and forcefully.
They were leaving their life marks everywhere.
Like that set the tone for the evening a bit. Mm. Like, just what the fuck were they coming from? But yeah, so in the theater, we sat all the way in the back, all the way to the left. And we didn't need to be, you know, so out of the way, because there were the four seniors, and then there was a person like down a couple rows from them. And then there was another single in the third row.
Yeah.
And the single in the third row, I think, was a woman, and she had like a babushka on. I never saw her face. And as we exited the theater at the end, I made a point to stare her down and see who it was. And she was turned, her back was completely turned to me. So she was sitting sideways in the seat, almost to very purposefully obscure her face from me.
Do you think it was Kirk Cameron?
I think it was Kirk. I'm pretty sure it was Kirk. That's gospel. We came in on some pre-show entertainment, and it was all faith-based.
It was just rapid faith-based.
Like, there were movies about first responders. There was multiple spots for something that's very near and dear to Bishki and myself. It's the Ark Encounter.
Yeah. For people not aware, in northern Kentucky, right near Cincinnati and the Ohio border, my brother got married in Kentucky, so...
I thought you were saying he got married at the Ark Encounter.
No, no. But,
like, I didn't know he was that cool.
While in Kentucky, I'm going to the Creation Museum, which is... that's the Ark Encounter is at the Creation Museum.
Oh, so it's part of the Creation
Museum. It's part of the Creation Museum. So you go to the Creation Museum, you see dinosaurs chilling with Adam and Eve.
Yeah.
You see the whole thing, and then... but the Ark Encounter was built after I had gone there.
So you have to go back.
So we have to go back to the Ark Encounter.
And I'm going
to
be right there. That's a road trip.
I'm there too.
Which is Noah,
oh, shit.
We'll go in 4x4.
We need to film this.
Guys, Noah's busy that day.
We're going right now, guys.
Dan, let me out.
We'll record on the way.
It's Noah's to scale Ark according to the units in the Bible. Just so everyone knows, two animals of each. There's some dinosaurs in the Ark.
So it's a giant scale replica of Noah's Ark.
Like in the Aronofsky movie.
The Aronofsky movie, yeah.
And inside, it is a museum that is crafted by and for people who literally believe that the animals marched in two by two. And the spokes critters for this museum a family of giraffes.
Yeah.
And they're all saying, look, mom, look at the living quarters.
Giraffe dad has like a bow tie.
That's how you know he's daddy.
Yeah. And daughter giraffe, I think she's wearing like a beret, and it's, yeah.
And they sprinkle it throughout the other faith-based promotions. So it's like, you'll see a preview for, you know, first responders, the dramatic motion picture. And then the giraffes will show up talking about the Ark Encounter. Then
it's like they're Mickey Mouse.
Focus on the family. Mm-hmm.
You'll see a Focus on the Family ad, and then the giraffes are back deeper inside the Ark talking about what they saw. And then they're on their way out on the last one, and they're like, we need to tell all our friends about this.
They're like Mr. DNA in a way.
Exactly.
Come on, guys, let's go check out the Ark and find out.
Let's indoctrinate everybody we know. So
then we got the Kendricks brothers.
The Kendricks brothers are the makers behind Lifemark, and they have a very distinct look. They are almost twins,
mm-hmm.
but yeah. one of them has this bizarre coif of silver hair on the top of his head, and he's got very
so much gel,
very dark eyebrows,
mm-hmm.
like. You don't trust that guy.
Yeah. And he has like a super well-groomed beard, but then like his mustache area is black.
Yeah.
And then it's almost like his brother is like, just has like a rectangle of like facial hair.
It's weird. And then Kirk Cameron pops up with a bag of popcorn in between him. And he's like, hey, what's going on here, guys? And it's really funny.
It's very Lynchian is what it is.
I mean, if you put just a drone behind it, like, and slow it down, maybe, you know, a quarter speed.
Add some strobe lights.
Add some strobes. Like, it is, it's so weird. And Kirk is just, he just thinks he's the funniest, cutest.
He's a jokester.
He's a jokester. He goofs around. But if you notice, whenever he's about to tell a goofy joke or make a funny, or if he's about to preach to you, he'll lick his lips in this weird way. And I don't know if it's just been latter-day Kirk or if he's been doing it his whole life. I mean, I might have to do a deep dive and go back through some of, maybe Fireproof when I finally watch it.
Yeah.
I'll watch his lips.
Fired up.
Yeah. I don't recall that in like Father Like Son, him doing that a whole lot. No,
that was before, I think that was before the shift toward Lifemark. But in this little pre-show thing, he licks his lips. And he looks out over the imaginary crowd in front of him. And, you know, he's goofing around. And he's like, hey, you couple in the third row, you need to settle down a little bit. And as we know, our babushka-wearing mystery woman, who may be Kirk himself, was the only person sitting in the third row. So it was so funny watching him speak through the screen to that solitary person and calling her a couple. That's worth $18 right there. I would have been fine to pay full freight for this, just for that. When he popped up between those filmmaker brothers, it reminded me of, there's these twins, and you can Google this, that would tour with Christopher Burke from Life Goes On and do like these musical performances. And the twins are just these two creepy dudes that you just wonder what, like, how are they siphoning money away from poor Chris? Like, what is their deal? They are not to be trusted. And that's exactly what I got from these guys. I'm like, what's your grift?
Lifemark goes on.
Lifemark goes on. And we were about to be marked by life. But before we talk about it.
Bishy, what's that shot?
From Rotten Tomatoes. David's comfortable world.
Yeah.
Is turned upside down when his birth mother unexpectedly reaches out to him, longing to meet the 18-year-old son she's only held once. With the encouragement of his adoptive parents, David embarks on a journey of discovery that leads to a staggering truth from his past. From executive producers Kirk Cameron and the Kendrick brothers, creators of War Room and Fireproof, comes Lifemark.
Pedigree.
Based on an incredibly true story that celebrates adoption,
yes,
reconciliation,
yes,
and love.
Yes, love above all.
Period.
Oh, that's it.
My first note would be, shouldn't his name not be David, but Mark instead?
I know.
That would be that would make so much
more
sense.
Well, we were craving some Lifemark illumination on what the fuck Lifemark means.
Oh, you find out.
Dear listener, fear not.
We're not going to spoil it for you.
We find out.
We find out a whole lot more, actually, at the very, like, the last 2 minutes were like, like Fight Club status. Like, holy shit, what just happened?
Yeah, yeah. So stay tuned, because this is going to be a bumpy ride. So right at the beginning, like, right from the get-go, just the production company was WTA Media, and it's coming out of, like a typewriter. And I think we all just thought it said WTF Media. Yeah. And it's just
like, it's by Mark Maron. He's there. Hey, guys, welcome to my new, joint venture.
Lock the pearly gates.
And also, it's no longer, they're no longer branded CamFam. It's Kirk Cameron Productions.
I think this is more serious.
Yeah, I guess. It's kind of like the Disney Touchstone offshoot.
Or maybe CamFam is more like his documentary arm of his company.
Well, that could also be part of this, which we'll get to.
Yeah, so we meet David, and he's giving me like Walter Jr. from Breaking Bad vibes. I don't know why, but there's something about him. And he is the adopted son of Grandpa Kirk. What did you guys think of Grandpa Kirk in this?
Man.
Very beautiful silver.
Oh, my God.
Sprayed on hair.
Like, the first thing I wrote down, you guys, is a very important question. Is Grandpa Kirk a zaddy in this film?
You know what?
Yes.
Yeah. I
hard
think so.
Yes. Yes.
Oh, he kind of resembles, and when he was wearing the glasses, for whatever reason, he kind of resembles, from what I'm seeing, modern day Matt Damon a little bit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I could see that.
And I want now more than anything a Matt Damon, Kirk Cam team up on a Bourne movie.
Oh my God, that's Mike Seaver.
The Bourne Lifemark.
Every time you see Grandpa Kirk in this, he's got like a bright colored shirt on.
A polo.
And he is very excited about whatever's happening. He's got like this dorky grin on his face, but he's very engaged. Like Grandpa Kirk, there's something to it.
He's rocking polos and pleated pants the entire movie. When he's just at home chilling, that's what he's wearing.
It's true. And his son is kind of a dim bulb in this. David, our central hero.
Yeah, he's kind of Christ-like. He's just like perfect. He's Everyone perfect. Loves him.
Oh, there is not a thing there's wrong with this kid.
Yeah, he does have some kind of brain thing that they go into where he gets brain surgery. But other than that, he is just the poster child for adoption.
Which, now that I remember that, why was that even a thing? The whole surgery, the brain thing?
Just to add a little bit of drama to a drama-less film.
Okay, got it, because there was no payoff to that. Got it.
And
okay.
He was a wrestler, and they needed to, it was too expensive to hire that many extras for wrestling meets. So, yeah, David is perfect, but if you look to the right of David, you'll find the first ever salad character.
Oh, God.
Oh, is that a new thing?
It's new. It's brand new. I guess I'm just a character. Nobody deserves to be anointed the first salad character more than Nate.
Our man, Nate.
David's best friend. And
flaming redheaded Nate.
Electric ginger.
I was not sitting anywhere near Bishke, but I knew. I knew Bishke was locked into this GIF machine of a human being. Can you describe Nate for the audience? Can you do him justice?
I mean, the whitest skin of all time with the reddest hair and just, you know, like they do have these characters in these faith-based movies that are just like, that have to provide the comic relief.
He's carrying all of it.
But he is just, he's on the camera. He's a viral video vlogger, and he's shooting everything at all times. So he's just
supposed to be 18. He looks 35.
Yeah, and he's just annoying as hell to everyone.
So bad.
To everyone watching the film, but also just everyone in the film.
He's always like, bugging people and filming them.
Yeah, and getting up in their faces, and I'm like, why are they doing this? Why is he like in every scene, like filming everything?
Anthony leaned over pretty early on after meeting Nate and was like, this kid's a menace.
He really is. But that said, I'm gonna defend Nate here.
Okay.
Because without Nate, this movie would be as dead as all the babies they claim that the single mothers were killing. That's what they were saying, not me.
That's true. I mean, Nate was...
He was like a hybrid between looking like Patton Oswalt Jr. with his looks.
Yes.
But he's also like trying to employ like a Dustin from Stranger Things type vibe.
Yeah. So, and a Philip Seymour Hoffman Jr. guy.
Right, right. A Cooper Hoffman.
Cooper Hoffman, thank you.
So... You know, for as annoying as he was, he definitely at least kept things moving along.
I mean, he held my attention.
Right.
Think what you will about him. You literally can't take your eyes off his red fucking hair.
And as we would find out later, very instrumental in this movie getting made.
Yes, that's true. Mm-hmm. So, Josh, tell me what you think. Did this feel at all like Dear Evan Hansen to you at any point?
I was literally thinking that so many points in this. I was like, oh my God, this is giving me so much Dear Evan Hansen. It's Evan Hansen-esque. Like, yeah, there's like this speech portion that we'll get to later. I was like, oh my God, like the letter writing.
Think about Kirk breaking into song in this. How great would that have been?
I don't want to think about that. But one note I do want to say about Nate is like, there was this weird touch of the effete to him.
Yes.
That I was like, have they explored each other's bodies?
Yes.
Like, I kept thinking, like, and that's like with that opening scene with all the boys jumping into the water and everything. And I was like, there's some, like, I don't know, is Kirk, much like Tyler Perry, allegedly, going through some like internal
stuff? I hope
stuff,
so. Sure, that would be,
I don't
great.
Know. I've not watched Kirk's other movies, but I'm like, this boy's very pretty and he's like a wrestler and like, you know.
Well, and he's all.
We got some shots.
Nate's always filming our dear boy David. And I leaned over at a certain point and I'm like, he's shooting for David's OnlyFans account, right? Like, that's what this whole thing is. So there's definitely a vibe. There's other very sexual vibes that we'll get to later as well. I don't think it was just me.
No.
No.
Was, nope.
Me too. So there's a four-wheeler chase. That's kind of the parkour scene of this.
Oh,
this
no. There's much film. More. Yeah, there's much more... extreme sports to come, but there is an ATV.
We meet the birth mother.
The birth mother. That's the drinking game.
Yeah. Oh my God.
Word birth mother is said at least 50 times in this movie. They're like, we got to meet the birth mother. Yes. Are you going to meet your birth mother? Don't you want to meet your birth mother?
Yes.
And it's just like, and that's the whole arc of the whole film.
And the birth mother has a husband played by one of the directors, I believe.
Yeah.
And... Yeah, it's all everything hinges on will they, won't they meet up, hook up.
And it's just dodging the whole issue of adoption and abortion by making this whole movie about meeting up with your birth mother. Like, it's just all the messiness of, you know, of adoption.
There's none of it.
There's nothing.
Everybody is completely supportive of everyone else. Psychotically supportive.
The adopted mom is so on board and over enthusiastic.
It's really uncomfortable. Like, she's like, go for it. It's really uncomfortable.
And it's just all Christian white people just psychotically supporting each other and crying and hugging.
Let's talk about the mom for a moment. The mother's performance, if you pay attention to it, which... By the end, you have to pay attention to it, but it's subtle at first. Like, she'll do these things where she'll pull her hands into her sweater sleeves when she's feeling vulnerable, but she's really show-offy about it. So it's...
Just so we're clear, we mean the adopted mom, right?
This is the adopted mom. Okay. This is Kirk Cameron's wife in the feature.
Yeah.
And she, from the word go, when her son... adopted son turns 18 and he's able to contact his birth mother, she is so on board. It is scary.
Right.
She's like, you should do it. You should do it. Yes, yes, yes. And that's usually the point of the conflict in these tales.
I was just going to say, there is no conflict at all. Like, the closest it came to conflict was when the birth mother suggests that they go, that she and her son go skydiving.
Yes.
And then I thought, oh, that's going to cause the his adopted parents to like, oh, maybe cause some sort of rift. Like, oh, she's kind of a wild child.
It's all played for laughs.
And that's it. And that's it. I thought it was actually going to go somewhere for like, you know, the cool parents versus the square parents. And that never pays off.
No. There's no conflict until...
No, till nothing. Till right now.
Well, till 90 minutes into the movie, but we'll get there. So there's some hot wrestling action. And seeing Grandpa Kirk cheer from the bleachers brought such a huge smile to my face. There's so many gifts in this movie, Bishki.
Yeah,
just some meat and potatoes, joyful reaction gifts.
Yeah.
And the salad character, Nate, is a walking gif. Like, yeah. Pick your gif. So... This movie starts flashing back and forth. And we go back to Kirk and his wife's trials and tribulations. They had two children that had died in childbirth or maybe stillborn. And they really want to adopt. So it's their journey of trying to adopt a child. And dear listener, the de-aging on these individuals is... It's a glory to behold. Like, Kirk doesn't need a whole lot, but they slather it on the wife.
Yeah, I felt really bad for her, actually.
It's embarrassing how blurred. And again, this isn't like Marvel de-aging. This isn't like making Robert Downey Jr. 20 again. This is Lifemark.
Yeah, I mean, at that point, they should have really just gotten another actor to play her. It was that bad.
It was like Snapchat.
Like, it was that bunny ears on.
Where it wasn't even like a de-aging filter. It was more like just like a chrome kind of, like, what do you, like that
just super sheen. Smooth out her entire
just
face.
Just blown out. And it's like, and then I think they had to put extra eyeliner on her. Otherwise, her eyes would have been like invisible or something.
Let me tell you about these eyes. She turns to camera at one point. And there's not a whole, like, the score will trickle in when it needs to, you know, tell you something emotional is happening. But there's a lot that it just lets you decide what your mood is going to be with what it shows you. And she turns toward the camera complete, like, just de-aging, like, full Irishman slathered all over her face. And it seeps into her eye in such a way where she looked like David Bowie in alien form in The Man Who Fell to Earth. And I'm just like, what did they do to her poor face?
Yeah.
And Kirk is looking, I mean, they do a good job with him, but he also is looking uncanny valley. You're like, is that CG, like a CG representation of Kirk? And just seeing them interact with these just smooth faces is hilarious.
Which also, that's when it clicked for me. At the beginning of the movie, I was like, why is Kirk Cameron acting so weird? Like, why is he acting so like, you guys?
Because he's trying to be old.
Yeah, he's trying to age himself up. So then when he's like acting like normal, jokey Kirk Cameron in his like, whatever, how old he is supposed to be in the past, it's not that weird.
And I was like, this mom, even through the mists of the de-aging, I was like, this mom looks familiar. And Bishki, she was part of another Fathom event, the Trump prophecy.
Oh, my God.
She was in the Trump prophecy. And Bishki and I have recounted this so many times on this very podcast, but the Trump prophecy was a Fathom event that we went to in which a demon tells a firefighter that Trump is about to be president.
What?
And then he goes and tells it on the mountain that, yes, indeed, we must support Trump in his victory. And they all blow shofar horns, and there's a like a 12 split screen of everybody blowing the horn. Highly recommended.
Yeah, we should have covered it.
So she was definitely at there January 6th is what you're saying.
She was there.
She was clearly there. God.
She was January 6th. So that's neither here nor there. But Kirk's voice also, his young self, feels like they might have fucked with his voice a little bit, kind of like in Midnight Sky.
Oh, man.
Notoriously, when Anthony's hero, George Clooney, decided to pitch up his voice in his DH scene. I don't know why they feel the need to fuck with the voices.
Like, yeah, just, that was...
You've already fucked with it enough. Just leave it alone, you know?
Cloondog, I'm still upset about that.
So the birth mother is lazily looking through these applications of all these parents that want to adopt her unborn baby. And she finally gets to the one that Kirk and his wife have submitted. And she reads that they like fishing. And she, that like hits her. She's like, oh my God. I have to call this. Like I have to call this person.
It's like really fishing. A big deal.
It's really a big deal. So she calls the future adopted mother from the Trump prophecy. And she's like, I have one question for you. How do you bait your hook? And which is a fucking quadruple entendre in and of itself. But they mean, how do you bait a fishing hook? And she thinks for a moment and she's like, I put the hook through the eye of the minnow. That's just how I've always done it. And she's like, you got the baby.
That's all it took.
Oh,
that's so like all it
what?
Took.
It was so weird.
What? It's so weird. And then you're not thinking about joy. You're thinking of a hook going through the eye and through the brain of a minnow. That's what, that's the connection. That brutality is the connection that spawned this whole endeavor. But it's meant to be just so joyous.
Yeah. It's like, oh, wow. They have a deep love over fishing. But it's like you're making this crucial decision.
Yes.
Over
how you bait your hook.
Yeah.
Josh, how do you bait your hook?
Oh, I'll tell you maybe after.
Yeah, that'll be off the air. But Nate's hanging around filming everything. And whenever we join Nate, we sometimes hear him mid conversation with somebody else and he's just ad-libbing, but he's ad-libbing like vlogger speak. So he'll just be like, yeah, you know, the JPEG, you rotate the JPEG. And then he's like, oh, wait, David, I got to talk to you. You know, I love those little moments. it's supposed to be just natural vlogger speak that we're eavesdropping on. But there's a scene with him and David in this restaurant where we establish that Dear Nate has a sister who's dating a ne'er-do-well, and she comes in and she's like, you weren't supposed to take mom's car. And until she said that, I'm like, is this his mom or his lover? Like, who is this? And so it was his sister. And then it's a small detail, but this shit bugs me. It's like you have a two-brother team supposedly watching this and making a call as to when you might need another take. Nate says to David, hey, I'm going to need a ride home. And David says, you drove me here. No, it should be you drove me. Wait, you. I'm just going to ditch this.
I feel you, though. I know
what you're saying. I know what you're saying. They botched it.
Hold on. You drove me.
No, I got it.
I can't even do it.
No, I got it. It should be you drove me here.
Yes. But he instead says, you drove me here.
Right. Emphasizes the here.
Take another take, y'all. Like, come on. I know it's just Lifemark, but try a little harder. So Nate continues filming David all the time. And it showed David's My People account when his mom is looking for him on the internet.
And it's completely unlocked. His mom's going through his videos, his photos.
She's going through everything.
Yeah.
And it's My People instead of MySpace.
His birth mother, by the way.
Yes. Yeah. And My People, we found out at the end, the director's name, Kevin Peoples.
Ah, yes.
So that's the people because it's P-E-E-P-L-E.
Yeah.
So that was pretty clever. Hats off to you. And so she's looking through all his shit. She sees all his videos. His privacy settings must be so loose.
Yeah, that's on him.
She's cracking up at a video of him and his friends diving into the water, like just jumping into some water. Like, what is she laughing at? Did the actress know what she was even looking at? Probably
clearly
not.
No. Clearly not.
But it's just funny to watch somebody bust a gut just watching people cliff diving. Like, what?
And then this is also being all cut in as well with David.
The speech competition.
Because earlier, David was invited by the head of the speech and debate team.
By low-budget Tim Meadows.
To give a speech about the importance of family. And he's like, I think you'd be really good at this.
But this teacher's a dumbass because the boy has no discernible speaking talent,
right?
Which also leads to bigger questions as to why is he even in this movie? Like, where did they get this kid? He is just a blank rock.
And what was the event? I didn't understand. Like, what was it? A competition?
It was a speech competition.
It was very unclear. Like, there was no like thorough line for that.
And he gives a very poorly read, kind of
like a Hallmark card,
blahly written speech. Yeah. And you think he's going to win top prize. Top prize is $500 cash, but he wins runner up. So he gets $250. For that speech.
Kirk was, Kirk was like crying about that.
Kirk was
Kirk's crying through at least a half hour of this movie.
Like, his eyes are moist.
He's just
doing so much emoting.
Yes. So then the kids go, David and Nate and their crew go to a party, a house party. That's all too brief. I'm like, let's hang out at this house party. I thought the whole thing was that David was going to get somebody pregnant. Like, compound this a little bit. Like, let's add some drama. But no, he just meets up with his buddies and Nate's there and he spies something off screen and he's like, come on, guys. And they start walking. I'm like, oh, they're going to go talk to some girls. No, Nate's just like, there's a snacks. It's like the most G-rated 18 plus party you've ever seen.
We got some snacks. We got some pop. Let's go.
It's really well lit. Like, there's too much light, no smoke, no drugs. So anyway, then Bishki decides to get up for a little thing we like to call a bathroom blooper.
Bishki's bathroom bloopers.
Sorry.
I missed something?
You missed something, dude. You missed the biggest laugh in the entire movie, which is not funny, mind you.
Yeah.
But it's Nate. He's interviewing David for something. I don't really know what it was. It's just part of his ongoing documentary. Mm-hmm. And David is like not emoting enough for Nate's liking.
Okay.
So he decides to over-emote and say, oh my God, I really want to meet my mom. And this kind of mugging for the camera bust everybody's guts up that wasn't us in the theater.
Oh, yeah.
They were just losing
it. The church group loved it.
They loved it. It was so fucking funny to them. And I just like to take a vacation into the mind that would not only laugh, not only like just... But double over?
Yeah. We were not in sync with the six other people in this
movie. No.
Absolutely. You know what it is, though?
Try as we might.
It's those kinds of people have not experienced the comedic heights of a movie like Jack and Jill.
That's a good point.
That's true. They haven't stretched out enough, you know? Yeah. Like, they need to experience the full spectrum.
But also, can we talk about, like, I don't know if this happened during this speech and debate portion, but... Birth mother,
yes,
while on the mypeople.com account,
yes,
is like, should I send David a friend request?
Oh, yeah.
While I'm still pending on a response from David, officially through the agency, she's like, yeah, I'm going to do it. It's almost as if like it was 11 o'clock at night. She had to have a third glass of wine. I was like, should I send a friend request to my ex? Yeah, I'm going to do it right now.
The vibes are romantic. It's like, oh my God. Very
uncomfortable. David and birth mother are.
I want to hook up with this guy, but I don't.
Sexual tension.
I don't really know how far he wants to go or if he's even interested. Is he interested in me?
It was like the end of The Social Network when Zuckerberg just had his computer, you know, friend requesting Rooney Mara's.
Exactly.
Just waiting for her to accept. Yeah.
And it's also Kirk and the adopted mom are pushing him to meet with her almost like she's like the girl they want him to court. Like she's got a good job. She's got a good family, good standing in the community. They're pushing him so hard and he's just like, I don't know.
Yeah, there's so much pressure on him. And I think that's supposed to be the dramatic element. But everyone's just so gung-ho, like, yeah, let's all get together and meet and hug. Like,
but it all
there's no drama in it.
But if you put it there.
Yeah.
I'm talking like David and his birth mother, there's something there.
Oh, no, there's
and
crazy
he's,
tension.
He's conferring with his parents. She's conferring with her husband. And it gets this When Harry Met Sally thing going with like Bruno Kirby and Carrie Fisher. Like, it's like they're coaching them on how to hook up. And it is so weird. Yeah. And it's purely unintentional. Like, there's no way anybody on set knew what was going on. And yet, fuck, it's there.
Yeah.
Like, you can't deny it when something like that is on screen.
Well, I mean, her character has a thumb ring, so clearly...
Two thumb rings.
Yeah. So there's, you know, there's something going on.
So back in the day, the younger Cam fam, the Irishman-faced Cam fam, finally get approved to take the baby home. And when the nurse puts the baby in the adoptive mother's arms, what she says is, you know, the music's blaring and she's crying and she's like, he feels perfect. But what I heard was her saying, I hate this part of it. I thought that's what she said. And I was like, wait, what? This is what you've wanted. And you hate this part of it? That's what happens when the starved mind is just trying to make drama out of anything.
Yeah.
And it's just not there. So David keeps hemming and hawing about meeting his birth mother. And
will they? Won't they? Are they going to hook up?
And then the mom finds out that he's ready to meet, and she gets giddy. It's like the dreamboat from high school just asked her to prom, and she's like, he asked. But she's telling her husband, and her husband takes on the air of like this friend. He's like, you did it. He really going to prom with the beefcake. It's so weird. And everybody's just so wildly supportive. Like you said, Bishki, like, they just want to get together and hug.
Yeah.
There's so many hugs in this movie.
So much hugging.
David also finds out he has a sister. And that's a big... That's a
huge revelation.
Huge revelation. Courtney. Is her name Courtney?
Yep, Courtney.
I had a question about that.
Though, yeah,
because,
me too.
Because the mother said, she tells her son, David, that Courtney, the sister, is fully biological, correct?
Yes.
So does that mean that she, and I know we're jumping ahead here, but does that mean that she and the birth father had another child post-David?
Yes, I think. Yeah,
but that's never ever communicated.
But correct. Then later they say she's a half sister.
No, that's David's child, not David. No, the father's child.
That's the biological father's. I don't know. It's all confusing. But
yeah,
it's confusing.
Courtney is a full sister of David, but it's not explained at all. There's nothing.
Yeah, it's not. It's not like, oh, you gave me up for adoption, but not my goddamn sister.
Right.
Yeah.
There's like a 6-year difference.
Yeah, 6 years exactly.
And so it's like, okay, so they were ready for a kid 6 years later, but then they divorce or something.
But that's never ever brought up. And then the father then, you know, produced a child with his current wife.
So now, so he's got another kid,
sister. And so that it's even said, oh, I have a full sister and a half sister.
The real story that this is purportedly based on, there's probably all sorts of messiness.
Oh, yeah. Without a doubt.
That this movie just
drug addiction.
And, the movie runs itself through a smoothing filter.
Bishki, you just got so dark.
I'm just saying.
probably.
Of course.
God.
Yeah. So when David finds out he has this sister, Courtney, Nate has a couple zingers loaded, because of course Nate. He does. And he says, just kind of out of the blue, like, Luke, I am your father, which tees himself up for saying, tell me your sister's name is Leia. Huge laughs from the five other souls in the theater. Huge.
And then he even says later, or tell me her name is Rey.
Yeah.
First of all, there's no way he's a fan of Rey. He's one of those toxic Star Wars fans.
Girl in my Star Wars?
Yeah, so he's not a... I'm not buying that for 1 second, Kendrick Bros.
So Nate's filming everything along the way. He continues to. And for as much, you know, viral expertise as he supposedly has, if you notice, his fingers and knuckles are covering the lens like 9 times out of 10 in this stupid thing.
I need to put in something right here. The only reason that he's traveling is because at the beginning of the movie, on his 18th birthday, he received train tickets.
Train ticket,
Because they're like, we know you love trains so much, now you can ride a train.
I didn't even think of that.
I thought about that. That didn't make any sense. So the parents are going to drive, but you're going to take a train.
Yeah, like,
I'll meet you there in St. Louis.
I was just letting it all wash over me. But yeah, why the fuck was he and Nate on a train?
Because there's more of those ambiguities right there.
That's right.
Which also, like, That's a weird gift.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, here's really just train tickets. It's like,
it's a creepy gift.
Is she going to train through like rural Indiana? Like,
yeah. It's only good for like 100 miles.
Yeah. Bishke, I'm going to give you a train ticket good for 100 miles in any direction this Christmas.
Cool.
It was like a Chekhov's train ticket.
Yeah, exactly. Oh my
god.
But that's
the thing. Like, there's so much teeing up for stuff that would have like its one moment and then it was done.
Right.
Like Kirk Cameron's weird acting. Like,
yes.
the train ticket. It's like, okay, then it just doesn't go anywhere.
And the movie's long, folks. Oh. It is long. So we finally get to the big moment where David and his birth mother are finally going to hook up.
It's steamy.
And they get together, they hug. Oh god, do they hug? And Nate's circling around them with his camera filming it. And then they all gather around in the living room. I'm like, guys, get thee to a Chili's.
But also, like, David's mom has to like push birth mom off,
which is
be like,
really
let me
weird.
Hug you.
Yeah. So they're all sitting around in the living room. You know, they all get to know each other. And then there's an incredible, incredible montage that I got to call a salad dragon.
The Salad Dragon.
A scene in a movie that is so bizarre, baffling, or transcendent that it instantly justifies the price of admission. Or Reese Witherspoon's leafy transformation in A Wrinkle in Time.
It goes into slow motion and suddenly what everybody wants to see, they're all playing Wii together.
Oh, yes. Wii Sports.
Yeah. And Nate's filming it in slow motion while eating a hamburger. And then he nods at the hamburger. What a cut up.
Oh, man. what a montage.
The montage was incredible.
And they're playing Wii, but you can't see the screen.
No, you'll never see the screen.
Yeah. Because, yeah.
And then the Lord blesses us and we get yet another salad dragon.
Double dragon.
Tell us about this flying dragon, Bishke.
Beautiful double dragon. We just saw a movie with Stephen Baldwin called Cutaway.
Yes.
Which is all about skydiving.
Highly recommended. Stephen Baldwin, Tom Berenger, and Dennis Rodman.
And so anyways, the birth mother says, let's go skydiving.
But in a very seductive kind of way.
Yeah. And so this is the sex scene, basically.
Yes. And Nate's there
filming it
against his will, but he's jumping out of the plane.
Gotta get that OnlyFans content.
Yeah.
He's cooking.
And we're flying through the air with Nate, birth mother, and David.
And when they show Nate, he's wildly gesticulating all over the place. And the music kind of shifts into like a baby elephant walk. Which is probably called Nate's theme on the original soundtrack.
And
Kirk's down below doing some cutesy leg crosses and uncrosses with the birth mother's husband.
Yeah. They're making some commentary on all the individuals.
That's a movie title, Birth Mother's Husband.
Yeah, it's just joyous skydiving and that's the ecstatic heights of the movie. Really.
Kirk and one of the Kendrick bros are on the ground,
yes,
looking up, totally gifting, like, yep, that's what they do. I wish I could explain it better, but it's just like the perfect gift for nonplussed.
It's great. We need it. So when they land, it gets even more sultry because the birth mother turns to David and she's like, there's one more thing I have to show you. And he's like, what is it? Are you going to tell me what it is? And she's like, not yet. You're like, what the fuck is this? And she's like, tomorrow morning. I'm like, ooh, morning delight.
Then he goes to see the birth dad, if that's a term.
Then he goes to see the birth dad.
And it's the same old scene. It's like, yes, hugging.
It's the exact same scene.
Everyone's supportive. Everyone loves each other.
But I don't understand why birth father had such a reluctance his entire life to disclose the fact that he had a son. He acts as if he, like, killed a family in a DUI accident like 20 years before and couldn't talk about
it. And speaking of that, this dad, he looks like he is about to become an active shooter at any moment. Like, he's got a hoodie on, he's got dark circles under his eyes.
I think he was the babushka we saw in the theater, actually.
It could have been him. I mean, he's obviously harboring great pain. And when they meet up with him, it is in the morning, I think. And he's got a fire pit going and four tiki torches, mm-hmm. like close to the fire pit, making like a square around the fire pit. And it looks like somebody's about to get voted out of the movie. But that's where they have this discussion. It's very odd.
Yeah.
But they come to terms and he meets another.
His half sister.
This is a half sister.
Half sister.
This is a half sister.
This is the half dragon.
Yeah. Where this is Azure's daughter. Azure being the wife of the birth father.
In the end credits, it's like Azure as Tiffany. So we're 90 minutes in at this point, and conflict suddenly arises, and it doesn't stop arising. Nate's older sister, it turns out, is pregnant. And to top that off, we finally find out what David's birth mother has been coyly hiding from him. She takes him down to the old haunted abortion clinic and
straight out of Unplanned.
Now, Bishke and I went to a film called Unplanned, and it was far more heavy-handed than this film is. Like,
yeah,
up to the 90-minute mark, the word abortion is not even uttered.
Mm-hmm.
It is a very soft touch.
Right.
Unplanned was not like that. Unplanned famously ends with my pillow entrepreneur, Mike Lindell, literally bulldozing a Planned Parenthood with his cross necklace gleaming in the sun.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That happens in a movie called Unplanned. Highly recommended if you're still listening to this particular podcast. Yeah. So when she starts talking and recounting her abortion story where she crossed the protester lines, it's always so interesting to see it from this perspective, because the protesters are like not saying awful things to her. They're right. They're saying like inspirational things that make her think. And she's like, they made me think.
Your baby has 10 fingers and 10 toes.
She yelled that at me, and I took that into my heart. It's like, why don't you show some of the other shit that they probably were actually yelling at her?
Bombings,
And then she goes in, and she's narrating this, and she's like, they make you pay immediately.
Is that how that works? Because I'm going to guess probably not.
It's that comforting old feeling where it's like, oh, here we go.
Yeah.
But also, don't they make you pay before most kind of medical procedures?
But yeah, these guys make you pay immediately. It's not
like you're going to buy a burger. Okay, I'll get that and that. And cool, how much do I owe you? Here's my card.
So she's about to have the procedure, and she says that she hears a voice, I guess the word of God,
mm-hmm,
telling her to get up. There's much work to do or something.
And the doctor could not have been more pissed off that he couldn't perform this abortion. He was like, what the fuck? You wasted my time. I'm going to tear off my gloves, throw them on the ground. Get out of my sight. I can't kill your child.
Yeah, straight out of the Roe v. Wade movie. Yeah.
He didn't say a word to me.
Not comforting at all.
I almost forgot we covered the Roe v. Wade movie deep in lockdown. If you're interested in this subject matter, dear listener, go back and listen to that one.
Yeah.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
But listeners, anyway, we're going to have a whole host of links at our webpage, lifemarkmovie.com.
So
they hide you when you go in, but not when you go out.
They don't protect you when you leave. They only protect you when you come in.
Protecting you from the protesters? So what do you...
So
they just kind of dodge around the key points of all of that. Yeah. Oh, and then she tops it off hugging David and saying they wanted to kill you in there.
That doctor was so pissed he couldn't kill you.
You almost played it cool, Kirk. I was almost going to applaud you for having such a light touch with this and just focusing purely on adoption.
Right.
Like, I was like, holy shit, this is like turning a new page for these faith-based, fear-mongering propaganda bullshit movies.
Right. Yeah. It had a very genteel touch to it.
They crammed it all into the back end, the ass end of the movie. They crammed it all in.
Which also, unsurprisingly, after they're at the abortion clinic, they all cry and they all hug each other.
They love hugging. So, finally, we get the answer to the phrase that pays, Lifemark. The birth mother gets sent from David a dog tag that says on it, this is to mark the day you chose life. And then her husband says Lifemark. And that's the final word of the film.
And then cue DiCaprio get pointing at the TV.
Yes, we all pointed. Yeah. It's like, oh my God, they knew we wanted to know. They knew we needed to know. And they saved it till the very end. Kudos on that front. But they don't let you get up. The directors appear pretty quickly after that. This is like built into the movie.
Yeah, we'll also come to find out the entire movie, which we just saw, is also based on an actual documentary. There is a real Nate.
There
is a real David.
Clips.
There is a real Kirk Cameron proxy.
It's mind-bending.
That blew me away.
They show clips, and sure enough, there's the birth father with his weird morning fire pit and four tiki torches actually happening. It's like, they're taking from what was on the camera. Like, wow.
Yeah, weird. It's like Welcome to Marwin. Yeah.
Yeah.
Welcome to Lifemark.
Welcome to Lifemark. So the directors show up and give some behind the scenes Easter eggs. They let you know that the real birth mother in real life plays the nurse that hands over the baby. And I remembered her. I clocked her because I leaned over to Anthony. I'm like, she looks like Dennis Quaid. And so I'm like, oh shit, Dennis Quaid is the birth mother.
It was actually Randy Quaid.
I'm sure Randy Quaid has seen this. But yeah, the director is just like, we didn't set out to make a political movie. And, you know, we were trying to play it cool in this theater.
Yeah.
But that's the part where we need to yell. Just be like, what the fuck are you saying, dude? Yeah. And he's like, we didn't know Roe versus Wade was going to be overturned. We just were following the Lord. It's like, dude.
Fucker.
And then he's
fuck
like,
you.
And then he's like, plug into love and let love lead us in our conduct. Then they have an acting consultant from the movie.
Talent consultant.
Like, what the fuck does that mean?
I don't even know what that
is. It's also actress and director.
And had an abortion.
She had an abortion. And she is interviewed about how God literally spoke to her heart and told her to repent for the abortion that she had. And she's like, God showed up immediately and I fell to my knees. And you're just like, what? Like, what are you guys
doing?
Why
include that?
Yeah. Why is this
they didn't want to be political.
Right. not at all.
But I will say, God might have rescued her from the sins of abortion, but he did not rescue her from the sins of that Botox.
Oh, my God.
Her face was frozen.
It was frozen. It was frozen in time.
Which, no shame, but her face was frozen.
It was frozen. Well, it's just facts. Then they talk to Kirk. He's, you know, he's got a couple things to say. And then they interview some guy who runs a bunch of women's centers.
Just
my body couldn't stop shivering when what the fuck does that mean in this context?
Yeah. He was like the only African American in this whole endeavor, basically.
And he says you need to watch this movie and then organize as life disciples to essentially go bug the fuck out of women that are about to have abortions.
Mm-hmm.
Fuck you.
Yeah.
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 Fuck you, Lifemark.
Let's go with them Lifemark bones. I can feel it in my bones. I mean, what a big pile of Lifemark. Who do I start with? Who the fuck do I... Brother Antony, you are first to bone.
First to bone.
Man, first to bone.
You set the table.
You know, I didn't know going in really anything about it. I thought it was about adoption and abortion. And
right.
And so I was hoping against hope that it would be, I don't know, like a lot more just polarized. Like when I want the faith-based joints and the right-wing propaganda, I want to be smacked on the face with it. I want to be so offended.
Yes.
And this was so goddamn gentle with like the lightest of touches that it's, and I hate to use this word, boring.
Big time.
Save for Nate.
Nate saves us all.
Yeah. So, I mean, you know, and again, I don't expect any major kind of third act, rug pull, but there's no conflict at all.
No.
It's just,
it's bizarre.
It's bizarre. Again, the people driving the film are Nate and an adopted mom.
Yes.
Give them their own movie. They should get together.
Crime spree.
He should somehow impregnate her. And then we have to figure out what this is. A live rewrite. I've never done a live rewrite.
Oh, it's a live rewrite from Antony.
Do it live. I'll write it and we'll do it live.
Oh, man. All right. Here we go. Pressure. They should then get together and then figure out, well, do I have this abortion? Nate then films it. That becomes his documentary.
Yes.
And then we get what was the name of the movie? I lived on Baker Street.
I lived on Parker Street.
On Parker Street. Well, this would be called I Lived on Parker Street 2, T-O-O.
Yes.
And that would finish off the Nate and adopted mom story.
And then Nate becomes David's half step. Father?
Yes, because he doesn't have enough half siblings or full siblings. It's never made clear.
That's good. Congratulations on your first live rewrite.
Thank you. LT, how do you do that every episode? That was like running a marathon. So, God, I'm conflicted. I do admire it for its soft touch. Like we said, it was just going to kind of like not even mention politics for like the last 20 minutes. But at the same time, I was bored to fucking beers.
Yeah, it was rough.
So,
what are you going to do?
This is a tough, what do I do? Do I give birth or do I kill it? And I think I'm going to kill it.
Oh, shit.
Sorry, we're going a woof.
That's a woof for Brother Anthony.
You know what? And that was my choice to make. No one else's choice. That was my choice to give
We didn't influence you.
You didn't talk me into it at all. That was my choice.
The life disciples tried, but they could not influence you. Brother Joshua, love and light. Love and life.
So I'd like to start this off by saying, or rather asking the car.
Yeah.
Am I going to be the first and only person in Letterboxd history to have Jean-Luc Godard's 1961 seminal Nouvelle Vague film, Une Femme Est Une Femme, followed by Lifemark?
Oh, right on top of each other. I think you're the first and only and ever.
Yeah.
And but also then I was thinking, wait, am I going to be the only person on Letterboxd to log this movie?
Maybe.
Period.
Maybe.
Oh, I'll join you.
Oh, God. Hit us up on Letterboxd, y'all. Good luck. You can find us at the Lifemark page.
Smash that like button.
R.I.P. Godard. Long live Kirk Cameron.
R.I.P. Godard. You would have hated Lifemark. This movie, I agree with everything Annie said. I thought this movie was very boring.
Very boring.
But it was boring mixed with like out of body experiences I kept having, where I'm like, oh my God, like I know these people.
Yes.
Like I know these people. Like I've met these people. I've had fellowship with these kinds of people. Like I prayed with these people. And I'm just like, oh God, like that cringe factor.
You've read watered down Left Behind novels.
Yes. Yes. But like, it was weird. It was that moment of like, this is so terrible and cringe, but there's a weird like joy I was getting out of like seeing these people on screen.
Zaddy Cameron was making me smile.
It was like a weird, like, I don't know, just like, oh yeah, And I was thinking about how like, oh, this movie's kind of competently made.
Right.
But then I was like, oh, they've jumped the line in this conversation scene so many times.
I mean,
like,
they gotta do that.
We just keep bouncing around. So yeah, I don't know. Like,
It's tough.
I mean, it's actually not, because like
I'm trying to invent some conflict here.
Because I was like, God, this is just all so enraging. Because at the end of the end of the day, this is a propaganda piece.
It is.
Because like, this is the best possible scenario, right? Like, you get in with a family that has the means. They have a giant house.
Yes.
They're normal. They're well-to-do. They love this kid.
They love him.
And
psychotically.
Yeah. And like, he has a great life.
Everybody wants to fuck him.
Yeah. And it's just like, that's not how this goes most of the time, you know? Like,
it's a fantasy.
And then there's all that manipulation of like, this is where I was gonna kill you. It's like, yeah, no shit, anyone else would be upset at that point. Like, yeah, I'd be like, oh yeah, I almost died here, okay, cool. Like
bringing your son to an abortion clinic and telling them all that?
To try to turn them on?
What the
hell? Weird. I mean, I was turned on.
Strange kink. Anyway.
I first was going to be like, oh, is she bringing him to like the daytime like lounge where she like, this is where she dances at night?
This is where she plies her trade.
Yeah. That's what it looked like. It looked like the outside like a strip S&M club.
S&M dungeon. Veil here.
Yeah.
Leave a life mark on your tuchus with my whip.
But yeah, I was like, just this terrible like pro-life propaganda. Yeah. And I was just like, this is the worst.
It devolves.
This is the worst. So to paraphrase Madonna in Papa Don't Preach, I'm not keeping my baby. This is a woof.
That's a woof. Wow, love it.
From Brother Josh. That's a double woof. That's the whole backseat is woofing.
Woof, woof.
Now, woof. Here's the deal. Bishki, this movie has a little character named Nate in it that I know you love. So what the fuck are you going to do right now?
Fuck.
And I also know what you want to do.
No, but there's something
There's something that you feel compelled to do.
There's a grandmaster plan tonight if the front seat complies. Okay. So, yeah.
You got to be honest, though.
No, this is whitewashed. just like, you know, because I have experiences with adoption in my family, and they did not turn out like this. You do not give birth. You do not adopt basically a sinless Jesus who's a wrestler and is just like
who goes on hugging sprees
and who just is just pure joy all the time. That's not how these things work out. And it's basically just trying to get Christians to, because there's going to be a massive influx now of unwanted children, and trying to get Christians to adopt your perfect baby who turns into a Christ-like figure, and
they're all going to be Christ.
And they're not going to step up and do it. And it just angers me to no end.
But you got Nate, dude.
But Nate was with his camera.
He was the Jar Jar Binks of this movie. You know it's true. And he may as well have been like animated, like a CG figment flying around.
No, I'm going to go home and watch Nate's, the original movie,
the
original documentary.
Let me know if you glean anything from that.
That movie I might give a half bone to, but this one I'm giving a woof.
That's a woof from Brother Bishki.
Three woofs.
Make it happen.
Listen, I don't want to disappoint you, but Nate is a potent figure in this film. He's got that bright red hair, and
it's unnaturally red.
It sears the eyeballs.
Yeah.
That said, to both the propagandist directors and everyone they interview in their little post-game wrap-up, I hope you all get properly fucked by history and you're forced to carry the shame to term, which is forever. This is a woof hard. We woofed hard tonight.
Official.
This feels good.
The first official in Lodge history, Finn Woof Hard.
Wow. We all woofed it.
Wow.
I was going to be kind to this film until that last little coda that they put on with the trip to the abortion clinic.
Mm-hmm.
My God. Like, what the fuck are you doing?
Yeah.
Right.
Because also, like, here's the thing. The insidious thing about this is, like, yeah, say, like, preach all you want about how, like, we need to take care of these people, we need to take care of these kids and adopt them, blah blah blah, you're still making a woman who doesn't want a kid go through a very traumatic experience of childbirth
forcing,
like,
it.
All these dudes being like, yeah, whatever, we'll adopt your kids, like, but you're making a woman who doesn't, like, at least when you want the kid, childbirth is hard. But at least you're like, well, I'm doing this for my kid right now that I want and I want to keep. Imagine if you're like, I'm just like shoving this kid out between my legs or some creepy Christian couple that won't stop harassing me.
That's right.
Yeah. Like, God, people, the worst.
And Kirk Cameron just licks his lips creepily and says,
he's just like, we got to do it with love.
We got to do it with love. Plug into love.
Plug into love, but, y'all.
But what if your kid has a weird congenital birth defect that caused their skull to suddenly start plugging causing into pressure?
No wrestling for you. Sorry.
But yeah. Then surgery magically fixes it and it's not a problem for the rest of the movie.
Forgotten. It's a rich family. They got no money.
Yeah.
They got money for train tickets.
They got health insurance.
Well, for a distance, not cross country.
Well, dear listener, have you? How you doing? How are you holding up?
Listener or us?
How are we? Yes, how are we doing?
I knew coming out of this was going to be, there was a lot to unpack, and we have done it. We've unpacked completely the suitcase.
So now hopefully Kirk will rest for a bit. He will lay down and stop making films so we can catch our breath a little bit.
Yeah.
Because we got to prepare for God's Not Dead Part 5.
Oh, man.
There's a lot on our plates. So This was a big hunk of life, Mark. I'm proud of this team. I'm so happy we did it together. Yes, Brother Josh, Brother Anthony. God bless you.
Yeah.
Ooh, God bless you, guys. Your fortitude. We woofed so hard tonight.
Yeah. Woof hard.
Man, yeah. I am proud. I am proud.
We are drained.
So. Yeah. Go hug and cry and just grip your life mother.
Right. I'm going to go watch the Laura Dern movie Citizen Ruth as cleanser.
Yeah. Perfect. That's a chaser. Perfect,
yeah, perfect it is. Palate cleanser.
Love it. Love and life, Mark, y'all.
Love and life.
Love and life, Mark.
Having my baby, what a lovely way of saying how much you love me. Having my baby, what a lovely way of saying what you're thinking of me. I can see it, your face is glowing. I can see it in your eyes, I'm happy and knowing that you're having my baby. You're the woman I love and I love what it's doing to you. Having my baby. You're a woman in love and I love what's going through you. The need inside you, I see it showing. Oh, the seed inside you, baby, do you feel it growing?
Grandpa Kirk a zaddy in this film?
You know what?
Yes.
Yeah.